So good evening, thank you very much, Pamela, for the warm introduction. It's always wonderful to come back to UCT because it is my home, and you'll see on a slide that I spent most of my life here. So I was born in Cape Town, I was educated in Cape Town, and then I left once I got married to work in the Eastern Cape, which is now my second home. And as Pamela was saying, it's especially heartwarming to come to UCT because I actually graduated from here. There's some dorky pictures of me when I graduated in 1996 with our class. So it's fantastic to be here. Thank you very much. Now, just I put that slide into mind. My son's 11 years old, and he said to Jens the other day he wants to get into organized crime. And Jens's response was public sector or private sector. But I put that slide in to remind me to ask you, I just want to get a sense of the audience. So if you don't mind, if you could indulge me, just by show of hands, how many of you come from the public sector? Fantastic. And how many, I'm assuming the rest are private sector, and how many are in the healthcare sector, irrespective of whether it's public or private healthcare space? Correct. So these are comrades, predominantly comrades. Thank you. It just helps me when I pitch the presentation. So I've been asked to share with you our story of transformation in the healthcare sector at our hospital. And as I explain the story, you will see that it's come about because of our approach to leadership at our facility, but also it's come about because of a team of people who've been very innovative in what we do and how we're doing it. So I'm going to give you a very high-level profile of the hospital, explain to you the challenges we faced when I arrived at the hospital 4 years ago, and then share with you what our strategy was, how we implemented it, and what the impact of that strategy was, before I close with the next steps and the way forward for us. So, organizational profile. For those of you who don't know, Frere Hospital is located in East London, and we are responsible for providing specialist services to the central region of the province. So that's about 2.8 million people within our drainage area. It's quite a busy hospital. We have just under 2,000 permanent employees with 23 sessional doctors, and we have an operational budget of just over R1 billion. We have 1,200 outpatient visits per day, and just on 45,000 inpatients for the year. So by our standards in the Eastern Cape, it's quite a busy hospital. And the challenges, so let me start at the top. You know, we're all from Cape Town, or most of us in the room are from Cape Town. You know that expression, we were clucked, you know, clucked? So my first 6 months on the job, I was clucked by the media. And so what you see on the screen before you, that's an abandoned woman, the waiting times was 4 to 6 hours. 2008, there was an expose about baby deaths at the hospital. And wherever we worked, throughout the hospital, it was dirty, broken equipment lying all over the show, and a bit run down and dilapidated. This story, when I tell the story, my staff laugh now, but it wasn't funny at the time. On my first full day in the job, I was sitting in my desk, you know, enjoying the CEO's big armchair, and I heard the singing and chanting out the window. And I tease my staff now and say, oh, what a warm welcome for the new CEO. Yeah, you're right, you're laughing because you know they were on strike. So there was a huge toy on my first day in the job. And it's because we owed our staff salaries and their benefits. And so they were very angry, and it wasn't a good place to start for your first day. On top of that, the confidence of the public in the hospital and the quality of care we provided was at an all-time low. And so people were complaining about the quality of care and the waiting times, etc. So I didn't run away. I had a rethink. Sat down with the team, and we had to come up with a turnaround, because clearly things could not continue the way it was. And so we went right back to what our mandate is. We needed to understand what it is that the hospital is supposed to be doing. And the first one, service delivery, is what we all know hospitals provide. But in the public sector, it's a little bit different, as you know, to the private sector, because we are also responsible for teaching and training and conducting research. And the third element that we have, which the private sector does not have, is the developmental component. So how, through what we do we contribute to the development of our country? How do we make this place, this country, more inclusive, more equal, non-sexist society? And we need to contribute to that through what we do. Once we knew and understood our mandate and confirmed it, we made sure that our mission statement was in line to our mandates. And we set a vision that for us was something we all could move towards. Now, vision. Laura's going to smile, because Laura has a friend, one of my twin daughters. Pamela did refer to it, but I've got a lot of my family and friends in the room, and it's really lovely to have them here. So my twin daughters are here, and she has a friend called Devon. And Devon said to Laura, he's going to Paris for the holiday. But he's quite a good-looking boy, so I'm sure Laura thought she should have taken that date with him, because now he was going to Paris. When the holiday came around, she called, which was in contact with Devon, and asked him, how's Paris? And Devon said, Paris is fine. He was in Bordeaux. So I put that in there to just emphasize the point that when you have a vision, you've got to have the same vision. You can't be thinking you're going to Paris, but you're on your way to Paris. And so we crafted this vision, and our strategy was very simple. Our strategy was to make sure that we provided patient-centered care. And we defined patient-centered care as three things. The first thing is that it must be safe, effective, and reliable. Secondly, it's got to be of a standard that our patients are satisfied with. And thirdly, it's got to address the burden of disease and the demand for that service. So that's how we define patient-centered care. And then we looked at all the support services, and we made sure that everything we did was realigned to support the core business of patient-centered care. And we focused on specific areas. The first one was just this culture of teamwork, because people were working in silos. Secondly, given that our staff were on strike, they needed to feel that they were valued. Thirdly, there were some key structures and systems that needed to be put in place. And as a new CEO, I needed to make sure that whatever changes we were introducing, they were visible and they were mission critical. And then, of course, the institutional glue that keeps it all together is the issue of leadership. So our approach at Frere has focused on two very important components, and often people tend to emphasize one and tend to neglect the other. At our hospital, we focused on both. The first aspect being leadership within the organization, and the second one was on improving the operations management. And I'm going to take you through how we did that in those two components. So starting with leadership, how did we rejuvenate leadership across the entire hospital? Well, leadership's got three components. The first level is yourself as the leader leading the institution. The second layer is the team that you work with in order to transform the organization. And then the third are the different layers within the organization. So starting with oneself, one of the things we tend to forget about is that we seem to think that it's only your technical ability that makes you good at your job, when in fact it's been proven that it's not just your cognitive abilities, but it's also your emotional and social intelligence. And we can chat more about that in the Q&A, but I'm assuming most of you know and understand. It's about understanding your own emotions and being able to manage it, and being able to understand the other person's emotions and being able to manage the relationship with the other person. Very important competencies for us to have as leaders. And the third element is your value. So I want to talk a little bit about the values. When I was nominated the first time for the BWA in our region before the national event, like a real nerd, I went and sat down and I did a timeline of my life. And I think it also was because I just turned 40. And you realize when you turn 40 to the young people in the room that you're halfway towards the end of your life. And you start thinking, what have I achieved and what do I want to achieve with my life? And so the social values, who I am, what I do, how I do it, has been informed by my parents, my family, the community, my teachers. And I'm in the public service for a reason. I'm there because I believe in social justice. And my work gives me an opportunity to be able to make a difference in the lives of people in society. So it's very important that there's congruence between what your personal values are and the values of the organization that you work for. I've also been very fortunate in that I've had exposure, as some of you in the room may have been, to profiles, psychometric profiles, and they're really useful. To the younger people in the room who are leaders and aspirant leaders, I would encourage you to have that profile, because it gives you a good sense of what your personal strengths are, but more importantly for me, it identified the things I could improve on, so things I could perhaps do better. And The other aspect that I've had, I've really been privileged, there was a study done in the Eastern Cape of executive leaders. And I had the opportunity to have my own emotional and social intelligence tested. And that allowed me also to identify what my competencies are, but what I can improve on. And I then approached National Treasury, I got funding, and we've actually tested all of our assistant directors, so 33 of them, all the way up to the directors, in order for us to understand the individual as well as the team competencies. And the next phase is that we've started coaching to assist the team to work together better. So that was exciting. At the team level, the first thing I did on the job was I flattened the hierarchy. So at Frere Hospital, you are on the top management team not because of your rank, because you're the director, as it was in the old days, it's based on your function. So if patient-centered care is our core business, then the assistant director for quality assurance is on our top management team, because it's not about her rank, it's about the contribution she makes in the team. And so that is just what it was before. Green blocks is what the EMT used to be. And you can see now it's a much richer, wider spread, and the input I get is far more diverse and richer. The second thing we did was typical storming. So when we had meetings, when I asked someone, did you do something? They'd say, no, I didn't do it because so-and-so didn't do his bit. And so there was a lot of blaming. People were also disengaged. They like to hide behind the computer instead of engaging. And so we came up with a set of rules that we would hold each other accountable to, what was acceptable and what was not acceptable. And at the end of each meeting, we would reflect not just on our progress in terms of the operations, but how are we progressing on as a team. And we'd go around the table so that everybody gets a chance to give a comment about how we're interacting as a team. And I'm very blessed. If you ask anyone in our team now or in the organization, what is the culture of the leadership? And you'll see, patient first came up front. This is how the team described themselves. And so we're now in the norming and forming stage. We're past the norming, we're now in the performing stage. And I'm very blessed to have a team that is a strategic think tank. They anticipate risks, and they will be able to put interventions in place. Often things get solved before it even gets to me, which is fantastic as a CEO. This picture at the bottom is the taxi strike, and it was province-wide. They blockaded all entrances and exits to all the major towns in the province. And so our staff, obviously, were not able to get around. And when we heard about the strike on the Thursday morning, we sat down as a management team, identified the critical areas in the hospital, worked out strategies to make sure that we kept those running. And I can tell you the next day, I can't tell you some of the interventions because it may put people's lives at risk. Because they made some really serious decisions to challenge the taxi war that was happening on the ground. And can I tell you, we never cancelled a single operation that day. We managed to keep ICU, casualty, maternity working. One staff member walked for 2 hours to bypass all of the obstructions and the fires and the barricades because she said, Doc, my one colleague lives in King Williamstown, she'll never get in and the patients need us. And that's, I'm blessed to have that type of person working at the hospital. Now, at an organization level, what we did was most organizations tend to focus on recruitment and training. But we didn't really think about how to engage and inspire our employees so that they can be committed to the values of the organization and what you're trying to achieve. So at our hospital, we focused on the engagement process and the inspiring process. And we renew our strategic framework, put organization supporting processes in place as well as people supporting processes. I actually spent the first 6 months of my job sitting in tea rooms, speaking to staff on the ground to understand what are their challenges, what are the things that work well, do they have any suggestions on how we can make things work better. And we then use that information to come up with the programs of action. So for example, so that top left picture is my striking Toi Toi employees, the same people I needed to transform the organization. And we started systematically addressing those issues causing dissatisfaction. So we paid, within 1 year, we paid 90% of all salaries and benefits owed. Within the first year, we employed 116 nurses in a 2-week period. By the second year, we'd employed 234 nurses. course, there was a high turnover. We only had a net gain of about 120 in that first 2 years, but it made a huge difference. You can't start improving quality of care if you don't have hands on deck to do the work. So employing the critical staff was important to us. We also made sure that we gave our staff the tools of trade. We try to build common ground. All of these pictures have so many rich stories, but because of time, I can't always take you to the stories. But the principle was about, instead of punishing someone when they did something, how did we instead try and build common ground so that you get them to work with us instead of punishing them? And so it wasn't a transactional approach at all to how we were leading the organization. And we encouraged teamwork at a service unit level. So when someone wrote in to say, thank you so much to the staff in D2, we would then go to D2, take a photograph of the entire team, and then send it out to the entire hospital. Because the doctor and the nurse can't do their job in D2 if the cleaner's not cleaned, if the finance person did not procure the equipment, if the pharmacy did not, etc., etc. You get the point. So it's all about how, when there's a complement to a service unit, we all celebrate and enjoy that because everyone has contributed to that patient's experience. And then to recognize, I'll touch on recognition later, and a very active wellness program that we started. I put this slide in to make the point that when you have a strategy, you've got to have consistency in your strategy and your actions. And so if we were talking about patient-centered care, if you look at our appointments, the blue in the 2013-14 year, the 2014-15 year, our appointments exceeded our terminations. And this was while I still had delegations. It turned around once they took delegations away, which is something I'll touch on towards the end. But when you look at those appointments, you can see that we concentrated on the clinical staff. And when it came to support staff, if we spoke about patient-centered care and experience of care being better, and we spoke about cleanliness being a priority, then you need cleaners. And so our recruitment strategy matched the organizational strategy and supported the organizational strategy. We also concentrated on the key drivers of motivation. So we know that there are three key drivers. The first one is the need to recognize and celebrate success. The second is that everybody wants to have the power and autonomy to do their jobs. And the third aspect is the sense of affiliation. And so at our hospital, we actually started programs and projects that focused on those three drivers. So let's say organizational success is an example. We were the best performing tertiary hospital in the Eastern Cape last year. And this is a photograph of our Nihau's secretary. Mr. Kalawe came up to my office. And what we try to encourage is that the trophy doesn't just sit in my office. Every employee wanted to see and hold this trophy because I was trying to emphasize that everyone contributed to us being the best performing hospital. And you can see that he looked so proud. He took the photograph so he could go and show his family what we had achieved and what he had achieved through his contribution. We also try and make an effort to recognize individual success as well as team successes. So these are photographs where Dr. Boone, the top left, is our pediatrician, and he was nominated for a national award. Our neurologist, who it was a personal achievement where she got a management degree. This year, in the middle, is our group. You see, many of us in the room all have undergraduate qualifications. Many of us have postgraduate qualifications. But we sometimes forget that some people never had access to that. And we had a program for our cleaners where they did a cleaning module. And I said to our staff, you know, I want to have a certificate ceremony for them. And it wasn't a big thing to us, but it was an important thing to recognize what they'd done. Can I tell you, when we had that certificate ceremony, they felt so proud. And they said, you know, Doc, we've never ever had anything like this before. And that achievement, it was such a sense of achievement for them that it encouraged the other cleaners because they said, we didn't know it's going to be such a big deal. We also want to go and train. And so it encouraged others to do it. But it's so important to recognize everybody along the chain. And we try and promote women. So on Women's Day every year, we run a feature where we promote how women are contributing to healthcare in a positive way at the hospital. And Pamela's touched on, from 2014 to date, we've had women who've been winners in the Women in Government and the Professional category in our region, and last year for the first time at a national level. I want to touch very briefly on power. In fact, in our province, they call me Mrs. Delegations because I'm always jumping up and down for delegations. I really believe that you need to give people the authority and the autonomy to manage that which they are responsible for. I don't micromanage my staff. I trust them to be doing what they should be doing, but I monitor the outputs through our performance dashboards. And so when they do it, how they do it, it's their business. They've just got to make sure that they do it. And so they are involved in planning. They are involved in the allocation of the resources. They're involved in managing their own budgets that have been allocated to them. Affiliation to an organization. How do you build affiliation to the organization? So I want to start out by saying that it's very important that what affects your staff must be important to you as the leader as well. And so our cleaners had a toy at the back of the hospital towards the end of last year, and they said, you know, Doc, you're going to Brazil. And you're winning all these big awards, but we are keeping your cleaning hospital, you're keeping your hospital clean. And we still get a level 2 salary while you fly off to Brazil. And I thought, you know, they're actually quite right. So we had a chat 2 hours. I still had to manage the strike and they still had to go back to work. But I agreed, I said to them I would work with them because it's not fair that a cleaner in a hospital gets the same salary as a cleaner working in an office in agriculture. The types of knowledge and skills that you require is completely different because you're interacting with patients, you're interacting with a team, you've got to know how to prevent and control infection because you're part of the hospital. And so that's my new mission, is to work with the cleaners to motivate that they should be at a higher salary level because they are different to the cleaners in the other sectors. So it's important to know what affects your staff. We have lots of moments where we share life and laughter in the hospital and the life of the hospital. That's me exercising with them, and you can see the pain and anguish on my face. So it's not just life and laughter, sometimes it's their tears as well. It's important as well that leadership is visible. And so when we do quality improvement projects, I encourage our line managers to be part of those projects. So whether it's turning around the administration and the folders project, you can see that Natosh is busy helping and working with them. If there's another project, I will be there with them, side by side with our workers, going through the projects, but also during crises. And we had a water outage in our town, and our team kicked into motion. You all right? The team kicked into motion. Sorry, the power's down for some obscure reason. Thank you. This gentleman, by the way, is from the Eastern Cape, and we discovered that most of the ICT team at UCT is from the Eastern Cape. So I was very proud to have him on the team tonight. Thank you. Okay, so let me continue. We had the water outage. It's another story on its own, which we don't have time for now. But you know, our engineering team came out every single night to monitor the water that we were having chucked in to connect the maternity to the main section of the hospital, as well as to connect the laundry to the reservoir. But the cleaners couldn't do work for a day and a half because there was no water until we connected them to the reservoir. And I came in at night to just speak to them and to say thank you very much. They were fantastic. I said, Doc, we can't work during the day, but if you give us off in the day, then we'll come back at night and we'll work a night shift, which was logical. So we allowed them to do that. And I went in during the night to just say thank you very much and to ask them how it's going. And they said, Doc, so sorry, we're not going to be able to catch up 3-4 days because it was Saturday, Sunday, Monday, and the Tuesday's washing. And I said, it's okay, just do your best. The next morning they called me. And the linen bags were full. They called me to say, Doc, we managed to clear all of the laundry. I was astounded. And so it's amazing what your staff can do when they're motivated. And the line managers were there with them throughout the whole process. We even helped the private sector. They called me to ask if they could please bring their renal dialysis patients to us because they couldn't achieve enough pressure in their hospital. And we restored pressure within 24 hours. And 2 of our nurses then said, Doc, do you mind? I think we need to come in to work with them because the private sisters don't know where all the equipment is. And so they volunteered to come in at night. It's amazing. And very important, every year we've started a tradition of doing a Christmas party to say thank you. At this Christmas party, we do a bribe for the staff, and the night staff we bought lunch bars that I got from money from the hospital board for. And it's really important to just say thank you, not just at Christmas time, but when staff on a day-to-day basis do something that we appreciate, we're in the habit of saying thank you, however small. And if you thought transformation has not happened, here's a photo I'm going to show you. That's Lucanio with the yellow shirt on. And Lucanio has got his two Afrikaans colleagues crying for him and serving him. So I said, that's transformation in action. All right, now, with respect to the developmental agenda, at our hospital, we believe that we have a social contract with our staff as well as with the community. And so when it comes to how we handle discipline, I believe in a what I call a progressive discipline approach. And we try and mediate rather than nail and punish. Obviously, it depends on the offense, because if you're stealing, it's a different offense. But when someone has done something in the incorrect way, we prefer that we engage with you and try and mediate. And so using that approach, our grievances have come down, our appeals have reduced, our conciliations, even with the CCMA, has come down, and discipline has seemed to improve. We have formal systems that help us contribute to building a non-racial, non-sexist society at the hospital. So we have a transformation forum, and this is a photograph of the management with the union leaders, because every quarter we have a training program. And it's really helped us, because as management, we now know and understand organizational rights, as do the unions. So Union X said, we're the majority union. For years, we're the majority union. And Vlachtis, once we did the training program, we realized that they are the most represented and not a majority union. So a majority union's got different rights. And that helped us understand how we need to work together better. And then, of course, the other training programs that we do. So we all have a consistent understanding of the law and the rules and the labor laws and how they apply at Frere Hospital. We also have a newsletter and interest. We've started, beside our internet site, we've also developed an intranet facility, because a lot of our staff don't have access to the internet. And this allows them to follow what's happening in the hospital. That was an anti-xenophobia march that we took part in. Xenophobia, as you know, is an issue in our country, and a lot of our doctors as well as our patients come from other African countries. And so our hospital will support civic movements. And when there's something that affects our hospital, we do participate. And this is myself with some of our line managers representing the hospital on that march. All right. I want to share with you that the training programs at our hospital is not just about training. It's actually an opportunity for you to improve the earning circumstances of your staff. And so the training and development component, this is Edison Fakadi. He, to tell you very briefly, he was an artisan, and within my first 2-3 months, the artisans and the workers in the facility section said to me, you know, Doc, your managers are racist, because we're actually doing the work with artisans, but they don't want to pay us as artisans. And we then set up a committee with 50% labor and 50% management, and we threshed it out, because our position was, let's assess your capabilities and recognize your prior learning, because the law allows us to accredit you with that certificate. It turned out, though, that they did not meet the requirements to be issued a certificate, but we had made a commitment that we would pay for their training and pay for their trade test. And Mr. Mfakadi was the first person to write the exam, but he failed. So we couldn't pay the 2,000 rand again. He'd be encouraging to save up the money, which he did. But when he passed, he came to my office and he had the certificate in the envelope. And he was so happy, he was beaming. And I thought, this is such a prestigious occasion for him. And I said, we have to tell the board, Mr. Mfakadi. So on the day of the board meeting, he came to, you know, Mr. Mfakadi was dressed in a beautiful, it was a yellow gold linen suit with a beautiful brown tie, and his hair was neat and his shoes were shining. It was such an important achievement to him and a milestone in his life that we informed the media, they did this beautiful story. He went from a level 2 salary to a level 5 salary, because we reserved the post for him so that we could absorb it. And this is the impact you can have on people's lives. And then, of course, we've got many social responsibility programs, such as our career days. For the first time at the bottom, we had Take a Girl Child to School, to work. And it's a previously disadvantaged school in the community. Of the 42 girls who came to our hospital that day, randomly selected, interested in any possible careers in healthcare, 31 had been born at our hospital. So there's, I know, it's amazing. And so it's amazing. We live in Cape Town, and I'm sure we all have a connection to Groote. However, in our town, there's like a deep personal connection to Frere Hospital, and I can see why. And these are some of the volunteers. We volunteered for the street store, and so you see my staff have volunteered to help the homeless people and create a shopping experience for them. And these are just some of the events we do. Now, this video, I put the video because I wanted to demonstrate that it's important as a leader, you want every employee in the organization to link what they do to what the organization is trying to achieve.
So, for disabled people, getting around without a wheelchair is a difficult situation. This is what led Frere Hospital to get a wheelchair repairman. Sanitopolisi fixes the hospital's wheelchairs, which has led to it being able to roll out more for those unable to walk. The police delivers the wheelchairs to patients. He works with the hospital's orthopedics to ensure the wheelchairs are suitable for patients.
Isn't that cool? He's a wheelchair mechanic, but he can see the connection between how he helps people, and he's come up with little innovative ways to provide the service. He designed a little car. It's called a maintenance plan for your wheelchair. And so every person gets a card, and on the day you get your wheelchair, he explains to you how to look after it, and every 6 months you must come back for a service, and he dutifully completes it, and isn't that fantastic? And that's Mr. Sunny Timolisi. Right, on the operations management, obviously governance is very important, and at our hospital we're blessed to have a brilliant ICT team. And Anton, the head of ICT, is very good at both the infrastructure as well as the information systems component. And so he does a lot of our design and development. But right up front, I made sure that all the key governance structures and coordinating structures were in place. In some cases, we changed the terms of reference, we changed who was sitting on the committee, and we changed who they reported to. And like I said, we used the ICT to develop specific automated performance dashboards. We helped and used them. We saved lots of money by using our internal team to customize and develop the patient systems. We're now developing an electronic patient record system. And we're making good progress with that. We launched our Facebook page and our internet site on the 15th of October. So all of you, I'm sure most of you have Facebook. If you just find Frere Hospital East London and like the page, you can then be kept up to date with what's happening at the hospital. And if you don't mind, later on this evening, I'd love a photo. A selfie, my daughter's got selfie arms. Or you can just get a selfie for the Facebook page of the hospital. Now, facilities management, we tend to see it in a very silo manner, but in fact, facilities management is an opportunity for you to demonstrate a visible change very quickly. And at our hospital, we started with basic cleanups. We went to the old sections of the hospital that were the most run down, and we cleaned it up. We did basic carpentry, painting, plumbing, just to make it a cleaner and better place. And every single year, we commissioned new service units. And so, not the entire hospital, but phase by phase, we're transforming the look and feel of the hospital. And so that top left-hand side is what the ward used to look like. And the other three pictures shows you how these wards have been transformed. They are no different to the private sector hospitals when you walk in terms of the look and the feel. It's a much better place for the patients to recover and recuperate in. You'll be shocked if you go there now. He used to be an intern at our hospital many years ago. And it's also a great place for the staff because it's bright and airy and spacious. And it really makes a big difference. It's the flow. It's more efficient. We can move and relocate patients. And that's what it looks like in the new sections. And no, that's not a private ward, that's our oncology unit, one of the adult oncology units. The other important aspect, besides being able to demonstrate visible change, is that you've got to align your facilities management activities and programs with the organizational strategy. And so all of our engineers and our clinical engineers think about how do they contribute to patient safety? How do they contribute to improving the experience of the patients? And so for the first time, we have a risk register for our plant and buildings, not just our equipment. And we prioritize how we allocate the budgets on the risk, the relative risk to not doing it. And so if it's high risk, it's going to impact on patient care, that is obviously what we need to do first. And so these are some of the projects that our engineering team has implemented since I've been there. So you make the electrical supply more stable so that we're not susceptible to outages. They have increased our diesel capacity of our generators. This one is in clinical engineering, which is about your medical equipment. It's no longer about using the money just to buy more equipment. It's all about how, when you purchase the equipment, how is that going to make your ability to diagnose easier, your ability to treat safer? That's how we now think about at clinical engineering. The other important aspect I thought I should mention is that we've got to invest our money in capital equipment wisely. And when you've made that investment, you've got to look after that investment. And so at our hospital, the total rand value of medical equipment, including all the surgical instrumentation, replacement value is just under 1 billion rand. We systematically, from when I took over, we systematically increased the allocation to purchase new equipment by reallocating budgets. When I get to financial management, I'll tell you how we did that. And we've systematically increased the medical equipment, but the bottom line shows that we didn't only increase and add to the equipment, but we demolished and got rid of broken equipment that we couldn't repair and that was standing around and clutching the organization. These bar graphs show you how we spent our money, 8.7 million rand on maintenance. It's controlled centrally. But the blue bars, you can see that we spent a lot of time in the early years on building and painting, electrical and mechanical. But as we move to the outer years, we're spending more money on materials because we've done the basic cleanups. We now keep the supplies in the stores to do the regular day-to-day maintenance and upgrades. We also focus on planned preventative maintenance. And so those were the old parts of the hospital. And we did a painting throughout. I think this is where I got this idea from my mother. And being a woman, a coat of paint makes a huge difference. And so what was orthopedics, for example, before, just by painting, cleaning, replacing broken windows, you can't tell the difference between orthopedics on the left and the new buildings on the right. That's the new and that's orthopedics. Just by painting them in similar colors and doing basic upgrades. And then there are lots of innovations. My dad always says that lazy people are clever people. Because you're lazy, you'll find clever ways of doing something in a simpler way. You're laughing, so you must be one of those. And so our engineers have found really clever ways, instead of having to carry the diesel all the way to the point, they've created this little tap and drain system, which elevates and tips the diesel. Really clever. And so at our hospital, you may have seen on the walls an article that said, Frere upgrade changes lives. And so our staff have realized that it's not just about a building, it's not just about a new piece of equipment, it's about how that investment in that equipment translates into better outcomes for our patients and better experiences of care. So that brings me to financial management. The one bugbear I have about financial management in the public sector is that we tend to think of financial management as two things. Cost cutting and clean audit. And it's way beyond that. So at our hospital, we went right back to looking at how do we increase our ability to bring money into over and above what government's allocating us? How do we utilize what we do have more effectively? How do we innovate? How do we do things differently? How do we eliminate and reduce wastage? How do we become more efficient? How do we leverage ICT? And so we have what we call cost-saving projects. I've told you about how you invest your money, your capital infrastructure better. And in our team, if you have a cost savings project, whatever savings you manage to achieve, you can hold some of that savings to offset your cost pressures in your area, and the rest goes into the kitty that the rest of the team can tap into to help them relieve their cost pressures. And so we try and work with donors and strategic partners. We accept anything. So whether it's the South African Jewish women who knit caps for our babies, to Carte Blanche that gave us effectively 20 million rand to give to the givers who want to donate another 20 million rand, to the banks who want to partner and teach and train our staff on financial wellness. Every strategic partnership is a resource that we can benefit from. Two companies contributed games for our children to play with. So little videos, especially for the children who have cancer and they have to be isolated. So they have little monitors and they can watch videos. They're beautiful, heart-touching gifts. And the bottom right-hand side is the Methodist church who came to sing for our patients. We have a teacher who volunteers and does art therapy for the children once a week. We have another teacher who comes to do music therapy. And these are people who volunteer and add value to what we do at the hospital. The other thing for managers is that they often tell us to do more with less, and no one tells us how to do more with less. So at our hospital, we looked at our cost drivers, and since we spent almost 70% on our budget on COE, our focus now is about how do we ensure that our staff is productive. We're now looking at staffing ratios and how we can move staff between wards, etc., in response to the burdens and workload in those wards. We also identified at this stage that incapacity had increased, and so through the provincial program, we are now processing those who are sitting at home with incapacity or applied for incapacity in order to either move them out of the system or to bring them back to work. And so we're starting to resolve and make sure that we have a more productive workforce. With drugs, typically your drugs escalate by 10 to 14% per year. So you would expect the blue graph to be increasing over time. And we managed to actually reduce our expenditure. The blue graph is the budget, and the brown graph is our expenditure. And we were spending 36 million rand per year in 2010-11, but we've managed over time to actually reduce our drug expenditure through a number of interventions. So one of the interventions was we had a drug holding value of 10.5 million rand. We've managed to reduce that to 4.5 and 4.9 million rand. So immediately you reduce your risk of expired drugs, you reduce your risk of the drugs being stolen. We also made sure that we adhere to the EDL, because a lot of the drugs were not on the EDL. We took all the scripts in polypharmacy and we reduced the number of scripts that should not have been there. So the auntie who comes with Brufen for her sore muscle keeps getting Brufen even though her muscle's no longer sore. We took all those scripts and we reviewed all of them and we actually eliminated and reduced the unnecessary polypharmacy. And there you can see our expired drugs. It's the levels less than the industry standard of 3%. We've always been under 1%. I've got a very jacked team in pharmacy. We also targeted other cost drivers like your NHLS and your blood, and by putting protocols in place and trying to adhere to those protocols, we've actually now managed to contain the expenditure without compromising care. And then we have quality improvement projects which focus on efficiencies around fuel utilization as well as electricity consumption. With the waste management, the point, what I try to illustrate with this bar graph, or the non-clinicians or the non-healthcare people in the room, colleagues, you can see medical waste here. By just segregating the waste, we managed to reduce the waste, medical waste, by 19%, but we increased the general waste by 22%. So what that in effect demonstrates is that we were taking our general waste and we were putting them into the red bags with medical waste, which cost you far more to dispose of. So just by segregating it properly, we were now reducing our expenditure when it came to waste disposal. Now, everything I've told you is the inputs and the processes of what we do. That will mean nothing if there's no improvement in the actual performance and our mandate. So let me share with you what our progress has been in terms of our performance. And I'm going to start out with our first mandate of patient-centered care. Okay. Now, patient-centered care, we focused on avoidable causes of death and reducing harm. And you can see that the CLU death rate, when I started, was sitting at 5.88 in that particular quarter and 5.6. And you can see that systematically over time we've reduced it. We're now sitting between 4.0, 4.4 in the second quarter and back down to 4.2. So if you look at the trend, it's downwards. We know that first world countries, the CLU death rate is between 2 and 4. So when we had that vision of Frere Hospital being world class, we're pursuing 2 to 4 range, and that's what we're working on at the hospital. And if you look at the annual performance, it's 24% lower than what we were 4 years ago. The same in the ICU, we tackled all the units where we had high incidence of deaths. We then identified what the people were dying of. We had a specific intervention at the ICU. And again, here we've managed to reduce the numbers of deaths. The annual average death rate has come down. The numbers of deaths has come down by 54%. And the rates have been reduced too. In terms of hospital-acquired infections, we've been beneath the national upper level of 5% consistently. When we had a spike of 5.8, we investigated why, we put the project intervention plan in place, and we managed to get the infection rates back down again. If you remove the ICU and the burns unit, because our ICU infection rates are beneath 10%, they range between 4 and 7% for kids and adults. But even if you take that out, you can see that it's less than 2% sepsis rates. Nosocomial infections in the hospital. Hospital-acquired pressure ulcers, we also reduced significantly from 38 per quarter, they came down to 14 to 16 per quarter. Then we lost nurses last year when they centralized the delegations and we saw it jump up a little bit, but then it stayed stable. But when it jumped up to 31, not this December, the previous December, I immediately called the matron to ask her what went wrong. And this is a list of all the things that went wrong in that particular quarter. So we immediately jumped onto it. And when you look at the next graph, you can see it's come back down. This December, we knew that it was going to be a similar risk profile as the previous December. So we were vigilant. And we were very relieved that we managed to keep the sepsis rates, I mean the hospital-acquired pressure ulcers down in that third quarter of this past year. Same with patient falls, we've had a spike at 11 now, but I had a look and it was related to the patients, not because of negligence or nurses not caring for the patients. So we'll keep an eye, but that also showed a downward trend. And then we have projects to promote the medication errors to reduce that in the hospital. We measure it before the intervention and we measure the impact after the intervention. So Pamela's showing me that I need to move. So I'm going to go very quickly through experience of care. This is the number of compliments and complaints. And you can see I love this graph because it shows a little turnaround. Where complaints were sitting up there and compliments down at the bottom, it's literally turned around. And what we did was we identified what people were complaining about. And we then put projects in place to address what they were complaining about. The first one being the outpatient waiting times at the pharmacy. And so we moved from an unhappy staff situation and waiting times of 4 to 5 hours. We mapped what the problems were. We then identified what our capacity was. We identified where we would like to go towards. And clearly we needed to change what we were doing and how we were doing. And so we put in place a number of interventions from employing more staff to digitizing the process to eliminating processes that didn't add any value. And the good news is that it's now between 45 minutes and an hour. Thank you. It gives our staff more time to engage with the patients. And the media didn't believe it. And so the day dispatch editor heard about this and he said, I'm going to test that someday. Oh, sure, but I didn't tell the staff. And of course I said, but just watch out because it's normally higher the day after a public holiday and the day before, as you know, because you split the patients. So guess when they sent them? June the 17th, the day after a public holiday. And vrachtis, it was within the 1.5 hours. They came back the second day and it was under an hour again. And so they wrote this article that said, it works, end to long waiting at the pharmacy, frustrating thing, queues a thing of the past of prayer. And the second project, very briefly, this was where we invested in appropriate x-ray and ultrasounds. We upgraded to the, and again I can give you details if you're interested during the Q&A. We invested in an MRI scanner and this table where before, without an MRI, we sent 172 patients to the private sector. It cost us just over 10,000 rand per person to have an MRI and reported on. And now, with our own MRI, we've done 902 patients. We managed to get the unit cost down to 833 rand per patient. It went back up to 2,000 because we lost our radiologist, and so we tried to get the private sector to report. But that 2,000 is still significantly lower than 10,000 per person that we were paying before. And we didn't just buy the MRI, we looked at the waiting area, which looked disgusting, and we replaced the windows, we made it a bit lighter, we painted it out, and so the whole look and feel is different. And we've also made it more efficient because we can now manage the patient flow. We employed 16 porters and the inpatient waiting day went from 10 days down to 24 hours for your MRI CT scan. In the outpatients, you wait for between 45 minutes and not more than an hour. And again, the investment in staff and in infrastructure must also result in improved throughput. So for us, it's not an achievement when you've employed someone or you've bought a piece of equipment. It becomes an achievement when your throughput increases, your waiting times come down, and the patient diagnostic ability improves. And so we had a 16% increase in the numbers of patients that we were seeing. Every year we've had year-on-year savings through the PACS intervention of just over 1.8 million rand. We've improved access to tertiary care, so every year we've developed new specialty services, and we've done more outreach. And in terms of efficiency of care, as you know, it's between 75 and 85. We've moved to try and keep it between 75 and 80% occupancy rates, which we've achieved in the last 3 years. The average length of stay is within the national norms. And the outpatient visits, we've actually increased the number of outpatients that we've seen by 6% compared to 4 years ago. And the PDE is your number of inpatients with outpatient days. If you look at the average inpatient and outpatients coming through the hospital compared to the average before that time, it's 18% more than what we were seeing before. We've pushed our registrar program and managed to have 30 of our registrars graduate. 80% of them are retained within the public sector. Our registrars program, as they graduated, our registrar numbers dropped. But we look to not only replace them, we've actually expanded the numbers of registrars that we accredited to train. And right now we have 54 in the system, and in about 3 or 4 months' time, we will then have 63 registrars in training. So it's nowhere near what you're doing as Critiscare, but it's quite a lot compared to where we were before. And we now have people coming from other countries wanting to train at Frere Hospital. This is a photograph of some of the students from the UK, Tanzania, and Denmark. So what lies ahead for Frere? One of our biggest challenges is then withdrawing our delegations, and you can see that the terminations are now above our appointments. So there's a negative growth in the last 2 years since they've taken delegations away. And that has a huge impact because you can see that when you don't replace your clinical support staff and your nursing, it's going to impact on your patient outcomes and experience of care. So as we go forward, our intention is to consolidate what we've been doing in the hospital, but it's also to look at the burden of disease, and we are doing more research now linked to the burden of disease. So I'll show you a video which illustrates that just now. We're also wanting to work more with the districts within our region, because we are not going to drop the death rate significantly if we don't start addressing the upstream activities in primary healthcare in the district hospitals. So that's what I'll be focusing on. And then, of course, I've got to work with the head office to try and find ways in which they can be reassured that we will not spend above what has been allocated to us, but at the same time, give us the autonomy to make decisions. Because you can't ask us to be responsive to what's happening on the ground, and you remove our ability to do so. So that's very important for us. Our strategy will remain focused on patient-centered care. However, we will be focusing on consolidating what we're doing through standard operating procedures. So we've changed behavior, but we've now got to embed that by building those into our standard operating procedures. And so we've been reviewing our policies and procedures for the last year and embedding these changed behaviors. And of course, leadership remains key. So when you come to Frere Hospital, the focus is about the best possible outcomes. You want to have a positive experience of care. We're preparing for NHI because when you come to us in the public sector, it's value for money. And unlike the private sector, you actually have a team of experts under the same roof that holds multidisciplinary meetings in order to discuss patient care. That gives us a competitive advantage. And so when we talk about those value outcomes, we've actually defined them. And our projects and programs are related to building that kind of value. So in summary, the focus was on leadership as well as operations management. We implemented quality improvement programs across the entire organization in every directorate. We used a systematic approach. So when we thought about how to reduce death, we went to everything from staffing to clinical equipment. Everybody thought about how do they contribute to solving that problem in their directorate. So it's about understanding what your core business is. People matter. It's not just about recruiting and training staff and leaving them to get on and do it. It's actually about thinking, how do I engage and how do I inspire them to be committed employees? And you've got to have the critical skills to be able to do the job. If we're in the business of saving lives, then measure performance not in terms of your inputs, measure performance on whether or not you're achieving your mandate. So are we saving lives? If we talk about the experience of care, are our patients satisfied, and are we measuring that to see whether or not we're on track? So in conclusion, at Frere Hospital in 2012-13, I suppose we were in the red, and the public and the community has recognized that there's been a turnaround in the hospital with improvements not only in the service section, but also in our academic mandate, as well as our developmental mandate. And it's so nice when you get a letter from a patient in the newspaper that says they're proud to be a Frere patient. And we've had to innovate. So we're now in a cycle of CQI. How do we continuously improve on what it is that we've done? We've gone from where we were to improve quality of care, revitalized infrastructure, although it's still work in progress. We're having engaged employees who are performing, and the public confidence has been restored in the hospital. So I wanted to close with this video, because we can't count ourselves to be successful if we're not delivering on our mandate. And this was a video that you may have seen on SABC about 2 weeks ago. It's in the news.
Therapy to stroke victims. Now the aim is to lower mortality and improve mobility on stroke patients. Doctors say victims are younger than in previous years.
65-year-old Nkosana Peter. He suffered a stroke in May, rushed to hospital and attended to on time within the golden 4.5-hour window period. The stroke has now been completely reversed.
Yes, the future looks good for any stroke patient, whether arriving within, you know, that 4.5-hour window or after. And I think that's important to note that, yes, you know, recognizing and reporting an acute stroke is of the utmost importance, because the thrombolytic therapy we can provide is life-saving.
I thought this was the end of my life. This disease paralyzes you. I can't believe I've managed to survive and be able to use my limbs and speak again. Even my mom was twisted to the right. I am very grateful.
You were the one time when I was a servant.
Facial drooping, arm drooping and slurred speech, some of the first symptoms people should look for. This CT scan, along with this team of dedicated medical practitioners, crucial to the successes registered here. These successes translate to less pressure on an already overworked health system. When I tell you, says ABC News, East London.
Now, when that played out on the news, Pamela, I'm wrapping up, they played it on the news, we had an influx of patients to medical outpatients, and so they were not happy with Stacey and they ended on TV, but it was about educating the community about stroke and what to do. And there's a belief now that there's a stroke machine of prayer that so a politician from the legislature sent me an SMS to say, the MEC says, please can you help us? I believe you have a stroke machine of prayer. But what was wonderful is that someone who's had a stroke 9 years ago came into the OPD. And even though we can't change that stroke that happened there, we are now able to assist them and prevent a re-stroke. Because you know, once you've had a stroke, you've got a higher risk of a second stroke. And we had another gentleman who's come in, he'd had a stroke 3 days before, and again, we could now bring him into the rehabilitation program to assist him. Another patient actually had atrial fibrillation. So he had a cardiac disease, probably building up a thrombus, and likely to have had a stroke later, but because he came in following this article, we were able to intervene. And so, it's really fantastic to work in the public sector and have an opportunity to transform lives. When I saw Mr. Peter, he jumped out of bed. He came in at midnight within an hour. It took us 62 minutes from point of arrival to administering the medication. He was paralyzed on the one side, mouth skew, and an hour after we administered the bolus dose, which was 15 minutes to do the CT, within 62 minutes we initiated treatment, he could move his limb. And the next day, Stacey, the neurologist, came in to look for her patient, and the bed was empty. She was devastated. She thought he died. And she went to the nurse's station. She said, where's Mr. Peter? Where's the body gone to? And they said, he's in the shower getting rest. So that's. I'm extremely blessed to be a civil servant and working in the public sector. And I never end off a presentation without acknowledging the contribution of my team at the hospital, our staff who are absolutely dedicated. And we're very blessed to have good support from the politicians in our province. Thank you. And I've said a lot, Pamela. It's taken almost an hour. And you may not remember everything that I've said, but I'm hoping that we've touched your heart in some way, and hopefully what our team has done will inspire some of you in a small way. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's always nice to have a good feel story as well. We hear so much negativity, everything out there, but some things are working. And Frere Hospital definitely, it sounds like it is working. I know that a lot of people, it's over their town that they used to be here, but I'm sure there might be one or two questions, so I think if we can just entertain a short number of questions. I'm going to do one half of the room at a time. I know that there are hands up. Can I just get more or less a sense of who all wants to ask a question? So we can just see our time management, and two on that side, one on this side. Okay, let's deal with that.
Thank you so much for the wonderful presentation. I'm Daniel, a visiting student from Yale University School of Management. And I feel like when you shape your not only the structure of your hospital, but also the culture of your hospital to be more innovative and more like customers, like to the patient. So I'm thinking like reform is not always easy, like even at the start. So I'm curious, what is the biggest challenge for you at that time when you start to reform, like implement all your strategies? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, you want to take a question?
The other one was just
one. Okay. I'm a child and adolescent psychiatrist, and I'm very inspired by your talk. There are no child and adolescent psychiatry services in the Eastern Cape, and I heard you say that you're going to introduce a subspecialty of specialty new service every year. I'd like to challenge you to think about child and adolescent psychiatric services for the Eastern Cape. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for serving the people in the big room.
Sorry,
I'm saying thank you for serving the needs of the people in the big room. My question, I'm also from Eastern Cape, actually. So, yeah. In a deal, so it's a village, Mbashi municipality. Yeah. My question is that you mentioned that you will implement e-visits in a hospital. And then have you thought about the payment method? Because I'm trying to think now, most people in Eastern Cape villages, they don't have credit cards to do like online payment. What option, cash payment? And also, you mentioned about your strategic partners, and I was thinking now, if you who conduct, if you want to partner with you, yeah.
Hi everyone, my name is Dr. Akin. I'm an EMBA student here at London School of Business. And I'm a clinical manager from the Eastern Cape. So I'm very proud to be here today. We have worked with Dr. Wagner in different contexts before within the Eastern Cape. And my wife is a doctor in anesthesia department in the hospital. So I just want to ask two quick questions. One has to do with outcomes. We know that outcomes are better in hospitals that are well managed. So management has become a core competency that leads to outcomes, patient outcomes in hospitals. What are you doing as a leadership in Frere Hospital to be able to help hospitals within the referral cluster to Frere Hospital? Not necessarily in clinical leadership, but in terms of management, because that's where one of the biggest problems are. Many of the hospitals are not as well managed, unfortunately, so to speak. And the second question has to do with expanding the services in Frere Hospital to be able to introduce a sort of private component. We know we get a lot of patients who are referred from all over the continent, especially,
who are looking for some of the services that are provided within the context of Frere Hospital. Many of them are able to pay and want to pay. And is there any space for creating that kind of public-private space where Frere Hospital can open a private wing in the near future? Thank you.
Those are the questions for now. I think let me give Jonathan. You're going to answer those. Okay, just you want to take one more?
Thank you. Now respond to that.
Thanks very much for presenting your achievement. It's very impressive. There are just two questions from my side. So working with the public sector, I think there are two major challenges. I think one is just change management, how to get people on board and how to break up silos. And the second thing, private sector, there seems to be never any money for anything, just put it that way. And even just to get a wall painted, and I strongly believe that your environment, that you can really change the working attitude by changing the environment and upgrading the environment. So just budget-wise, did it change? Where did you get the money from?
Thank you very much for those questions and comments. I'll start with, Daniel, I'll start with you. You spoke about the culture and how do we change the culture and the behavior. And remember, I started off with the first day, people want strikes. So I'm really angry at people. And so the first thing I needed to tackle was clearly that we needed to pay the workers because I don't see the patients. My staff see the patients. So I need to look after my staff and enable them in order for them to look after the patients. And we started out in the HR section, which was chaotic. It was a mess. Broken shelving, files all over the show. And I said, when you walk in here, I don't blame the employees for being upset because we don't give the impression that we know what's going on and that we're in control. So let's clean up about improving the environment. And so the cleaners in I didn't know that the ground staff are not supposed to be asked to help clean. I just thought we all work together when there's a problem, you know. But fortunately, as you know, power, there's a number of different types of powers, and one of them is using your authority. So because government tends to be very hierarchical, when the CEO says that something must be done, 9.5 times out of 10 it will be done. But I don't abuse that type of authority. I prefer using influence. And so with my team, we asked them to please come and help. They came to help, and then the second day, it still wasn't done. They said, Doc, it's childbirth time. Time to go home now. I said, but when are we going to finish? Don't worry, Doc, it's Wednesday. We'll come back Friday. I said, are you sure? No, Wednesday, Friday will be done. Friday morning, I walked in, and the dirt was in the same place as before. Nothing had been done. The box for the broken fan was in the same place. The dustbin was still around it. I was livid. There are lots of Cape Town words to describe how I actually felt. But I was livid. I could feel the steam escape. I got my mum's temper. And out of my nostrils. So I breathed, and I went to my office, and I called that entire team. Because remember, I've only been on the job for four or five days. I didn't know who the two guys who said, child out time, we're coming back. So I called the whole team up with their managers. And I sat them down, and I made sure, I must confess, I did use the authority thing because it was a room full of men and I was a woman. So I stood while they all sat. And I then had a conversation which started out with, you don't know me. I can't believe you would not do what you're saying you wanted to do because that's insubordinate. And I could charge you, but I thought you can't know me for you to have been insubordinate. You know, something must have gone wrong because you said to me that you would have it cleaned by Friday. And I'm looking at all of you now and I'm thinking, what kind of a man is that who says he's going to do something and he doesn't do it? Hell, were the men shifting on their chairs, eh? They were so awkward. And eventually, to cut a long story short, they said, you know, Doc, you're right. Because I said, this is how things may have been, but it's not going to happen while I'm here. Because trust me, if I need to slam you for being insubordinate, I'll do so. But this time I've decided to give you the benefit of the doubt because you don't know me. You don't know that I would do that. And then the guy stood up and he said, no, Doc, we're really sorry. You're right. It is like this. We will do it. And then the one guy put his hand up. He said, Doc, it was me. But you know, we were on strike yesterday. That's why I didn't do it. Now, they were on the strike the day before because head office hadn't done something. But within an hour and a half, we negotiated them back to work. So I immediately jumped onto it and I said, So you weren't working yesterday. That means I have to dock your salary for unpaid. Ooh, no. You don't need to dock me. No, you're sorry. He was working. He should have done it. He was wrong. And so we had to set the tone right up front. Same thing with my managers. I'd say, Non-Claire, when did you say the dinner would be here? 11 o'clock, Doc. Non-Claire, well, can I come and check it at 11? Yes, Doc, I asked them to do it. I said, no, Non-Claire, I'm not asking them. Did you ask them to do it? I'm asking you, did you do it? Hold on, Doc. Non-Claire comes back to me. Doc, they say it's done. No, Non-Claire, I'm not asking you, did they say it's done? I'm asking you, my manager, is it done? And so I had to build repetitively that my managers need to be accountable. And they must not only know that it has been done, they must have checked it before I get there. Because if I get there and it's not at the standard, then, you know, the repercussions will follow. But I'm very lucky. I prefer, my brother knows, I'd rather train my dogs with affection and make them want to love me and do things for me rather than me having to punish them. But I'm not above disciplining when it's required. So that is how we have to walk the talk and to change the culture. And ma'am, I'm not sure what literature you were referring to, or maybe I don't understand the psychologist, because we do have psychiatric services. Cecilia Makiwani is the designated mental health facility. St. Barnabas is now nearing completion in the Transkei, because we did have a lack of psychiatric facilities on that side of the province. And so we do have mental health units that are functioning with psychiatric services and psychologists. We don't have as many psychologists as we should have, I agree. But to my understanding, we do have that. We're not designated to be the mental health facility, but we do provide 72-hour services in line with the law. But I'll look into it so that I understand your question a bit better. The gentleman from Elliottdale, I've been to Elliottdale, it snows there in winter, but it's freezing. You get snowed in often. Thank you for the question. We have debtors. Debtors are valued, it's now at 75 million rand. Among the debtors are people who come to use the service, but they're also correctional services, people with medical aids, etc. And we short staff like the rest of you. We don't have a lot of people in our finance section, in the revenue section. So I've said to our staff, besides looking at systems improvements, I've said to them, don't concentrate on your time chasing the man who lives in Elliot for his few rands, because we know people are struggling. Rather use the time available to chase up the medical aids, correctional services, and RAF, because there we know we're guaranteed a better chance of getting our money back. And so our focus has not been, if someone is able to pay, we encourage them to pay. We have got facilities where you can pay cash. We don't use the EFT system, it is a cash system. And we're introducing the card system at the hospital. But our focus is not on the small person household who's already struggling. If you spend all your time trying to track down the shack in the location, that's not our core business, quite frankly. You know, I'd rather that they concentrate on what they can achieve. Then Dr. my comrade and colleague from the Eastern Cape. So you're quite right. What we need to do, we formed a central region committee, and on the committee are all the clinical managers as well as the district managers. And it's about how we now shift beyond Frere Hospital to looking at how we reduce maternal deaths, neonatal deaths within the region. Like the rest of the world, we're grappling with neonatal deaths and stillbirths. But there have also been the good research articles that are advising us on good, sort of cost-effective interventions that can reduce stillbirths in the country. And that is what I'd like to pursue now within the region. And so we have formed the Central Region Collaboration. It's now to make sure that we sit regularly on a quarterly basis implementing programs. And one of the reasons we formed the collaboration is instead of us having sporadic interventions, we want to coordinate our resources, pool our resources to tackle programs that will benefit us and ensure continuity of care within the region. So that's the phase that we're in now, sir. It's like, I think, I'm not sure what exactly the adage is, but it says the cobbler never sees to his own family's shoes. You know, you're always busy with everybody else's shoes. So it was a conscious decision that I would focus on Frere turnaround for 3 years, and then in the outer years, move towards the region and looking at how we can improve healthcare within the region. You were also asking about private sector. So this is being recorded, which means I must make reference to what our minister has said. So our minister did not support the statement he made, I think, 3 years ago. He doesn't support that we have private wings. I know that you do have it de facto with the private section at Goedeskeer, and I know Tigerberg Hospital also had a private unit. At our hospital, I was asked by two kings, and I won't say which kings asked me. The chief said, Doc, if our king comes to Frere Hospital, what special treatment can he get? oh, I mean, how do you say the right thing or the wrong thing there? And I thought for a second, and then I said, you know, so the good thing is everybody who comes to Frere Hospital gets treated like he's the king. And so we, but then I said, on a serious note, we have a GR system, and so I'm very blessed. Our politicians don't insist on privilege. They understand the clinical system. They understand that everybody's equal, because that's my job. I'm a steward for every person, irrespective of where they come from and their background. So that's a long answer to say that we won't have a private wing, because when the private patient comes, they will get the same treatment as our patient who's not a private patient, because the care and the standard of care is to be the same. That's what public sector is about. It's about social justice. It's giving that person, who already starts off with so many disadvantages in life, giving him the access to the best possible care, the same care that a private person would get. And that's what we aim to do. So already, we have unique specialty services that the private sector does not have. And so pediatric oncology, they don't have a pediatric oncologist, they don't have infectious diseases, they don't have a neurologist. So already their patients are starting to come through to us. What I have to do is I've got to make sure that there's a balance. So not just to recoup the money, but there's a balance that we don't have so many private patients that they squeeze out on public sector. Because our main focus is for the public sector. And we're looking at revenue generating projects now, where we're going to increase our arthroplastic services from the 100 we're doing per year to 300 through that strategic partnership. And I'm hoping the model that I've done, but I'm not a finance guy, so I need National Treasury to help us with it. The model is that the private patients would cross-subsidize, because we'd retain the revenue, they would cross-subsidize the public sector patients. So it works on paper, but I need them to help me with the model. And then the last question. The other thing I wanted to share with you, I went to Cuba 4 years ago. And Cuba, because they were blockaded, they had to be innovative. They had to come up and design and develop and then manufacture their own vaccines, for example, their own medical equipment, things that we take for granted. Because of the blockade, they couldn't bring it into their country. And what they realized was that they were inventing and producing, but they were not commercializing it. And so they went through a program of actually commercializing it. And so in Cuba, you can go from outside into a country just to go and have a particular hospital for a particular procedure and then fly back. So I'll tell you about it another time. It's just top secret at the moment, but we're busy working on a project which looks at medical tourism. And it's a particular service where once we get that right, we will then open it and it will become another avenue of medical tourism. So watch this space. Then the last question, ma'am, you were asking, how did we get the money? Where did the money come from? So, if you look at the literature, it says that in any organization, you are highly likely able to eliminate waste and have savings of up to 3% on your operational budget. So we set a target of 3% with a 1.1% each year. We took the money and we deliberately decreased the allocation in the next year because we assumed that our cost savings projects would be effective. So we allocated resources for the cost-saving projects. Like I said, we used strategic partnerships to bring in additional resources that we would not normally have had. And the PACS project, it helped us free up 1.8 million rand within a year, which we could then utilize for basic equipment within clinical support services. So we had the same funding envelope. We just reprioritized within the envelope. We used the cost-savings project. Every single component has a cost-savings project. So our engineers, for example, we eliminated the steam leaks and we repaired our boilers, because when a boiler went down, it took 2 to 3 days to get an engineer to come up from Joburg or Cape Town to repair it. And so the patient suffered with cold water, food couldn't be cooked, it was a nightmare. We now have 2 functional boilers for the last 3 years. However, we don't put both on at the same time. And I made a decision to rather risk that if one goes down, it would be a 2 to 3 hour wait to kickstart the other one and get it up to speed, because it saves money. So all of us, every single person looks at how do we save money? How do we not waste the money that's been given to us? So our biggest challenge is more on the funds allocated for COE, the cost of employment. But for the rest, we look at the drugs. The drugs was an example, NHLS, blood. We reduced waste and inefficiencies to try and create some maneuvering space. Of course, we'd always welcome an increased budget anyway. But that has helped us. I'm hoping I've answered all the questions. Change management. All right, so there are lots of theories around change management, and I'm not a guru on change management, but I found the thing that works the best is that you've got to walk the talk. Now, there's got to be congruence and consistency in what you say and what you do and how you behave. Because if you're not walking the change, then how do you get your staff to believe you? So, for example, when we had to pay the overtime for staff, and we were owing them the overtime, I made sure we did not pay my benefit first. We made sure that we paid the workers, that they got their money first, and I made sure that the managers got theirs last. So that way, when you lead by example, it's easy to bring people along. Because, and the other thing is you've got to be authentic. When you interact with your staff, they've got to feel that the CEO understands what we're saying. She has empathy. So you use your emotional intelligence to connect with people so that they feel that you're authentic, that you understand them, that you have empathy, so that when you take your position, however strict it be, is people understand because they feel that they've been hurt. And so I found that the emotional intelligence competencies come into play a lot with change management, not just the theories of change management. Thank you. Thank you very much for the questions.